Welcome to The Culture Edit, unique perspectives into the personal and professional lives of individuals at the helm of successful business, athletics, art, and design.
Welcome to The Culture Edit, episode 59.
59.
Feeling fine.
The episode is How I Feel, 59.
But you're not 59.
No, I just feel like it. Apparently, aging comes in waves. With the big wave coming at 44, that's in the Culture Edit newsletter this week. So that was good. That was good confirmation for me.
Well, this weekend we did have a good workout weekend. We've finally been in town for two consecutive weekends in a row, which is nice. And next weekend we'll be in town as well. So we were able to actually get out and enjoy the first. I feel like first real weekend of fall.
Yeah. How many miles did you run? Saturday and Sunday.
Oh, total?
Yeah.
21 total. Okay. 6 miles on Saturday.
So you ran a marathon.
Yeah, 6 miles on Saturday, 15 miles on Sunday.
Wow.
But it was my biggest week, running week total, because I ran like 36 miles. So that's the most miles I've ever run in
it's
a
huge.
Week.
Yeah.
Which I know for all the marathoners out there, that's like nothing, but I've been doing a slow build up because I don't want to get injured. So it's a milestone for me.
Like that you put all your hands in there, all the marathoners out there.
Well, because you know, people are like, ooh, like I do like 90 mile weeks, but.
Oh, really?
That's a recipe for injury.
Well, I mean, that explains why we tried on Sunday afternoon. We took little Emmy to the park and we tried to lay down a blanket and have a glass of wine, but. It was pretty painful for us to just even sit there. We couldn't picnic.
No, we couldn't picnic because we were like it's so sore. Because, I mean, what did you do on Sunday?
I did the Skeena ride route in the mountains. So if you're familiar with the gaps, we did Wolfpin. Sorry, I guess we did Woody Long, Wolfpin Short, then Skeena, which I think most people in Atlanta are not that familiar with because I've mentioned to people and they don't know about it, but 67 miles around 6,000 feet of climbing.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah. It's a good, I mean, it's a good route. It's hard. It's not easy.
Yeah. No, but it was like perfect 5-star Chamber of Commerce type weather. I mean, it was 55 whenever we started and it was
Chamber of Commerce type weather.
Yeah. That's a, that's a saying.
I've never heard that before.
Really?
No.
It's like, you know what a Chamber of Commerce is?
Yeah.
It's like, you know, they want to bring businesses to the city. Yeah, yeah. So they would bring in potential businesses only when the weather was perfect.
Oh, I guess, yeah, that makes sense, but I've never heard that saying.
Yeah. So basically just the fall for Atlanta.
Yeah. Yeah. No, Saturday was a little muggy. It was cooler, but it was like super humid.
Yeah.
But Sunday, I mean, it was, the humidity was virtually nothing. I barely sweat for all 15 miles. And it was perfect.
Yeah, no, it was a really stark contrast to last weekend because we did the exact same thing last weekend. Yeah. So Sunday to Sunday, last Sunday was hot and humid in the gaps in the mountains. And then I went up there with just a jersey and shorts and it was 55 at the start. So I was pretty cold.
Well, my hope is that this isn't fake fall and that it's actual fall. I know that at some point we will get a fake fall and it'll get hot again. I mean, it's not like blistering hot today, but it is a little warmer.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping maybe that's like the biggest fluctuation we'll see and then it'll just stay cruising into the 60s and 70s.
Yeah, we're definitely not consistent right now. It's like mid 80s.
I just want the mosquitoes to go away.
Today's the Apple event, which I thought was ironic for you.
Yeah. Yeah, Saturday actually wasn't that great of a day for me because I initially wanted to do my long run on Saturday and felt like doggy poo poo when I started running. And then after I just like, and I don't give up on runs very easily. Like I'm not that person who's like, oh, like I feel like crap, I'm gonna turn around. I usually give myself like a 10K before I can like truly give up on the run. And after 10K, I still don't feel good. Then I know it's like probably not a good, like, especially if like your knee's hurting or if there's some sort of thing that's hurting.
Yeah.
Besides just being tired. Cause I don't feel like being tired is necessarily an excuse to stop. But then after I stopped, I go to Kroger. I'm like, whatever. I'll just get like a nice little drink or juice. And then on the way home, I pull my phone out and just slam it into the ground and shatter it.
Smashed.
Just smashed. And like, I just got it like a year ago.
Like so not repairable.
Yeah. Well, the like touchscreen doesn't even work.
Yeah.
So then luckily you have an extra phone.
I reminded you. I said we have an extra phone.
Yeah.
Oh, and operational.
Semi-operational.
Semi-operational extra phone in the house.
The only way I can talk on it is if I use my AirPods. So
the speakerphone works.
And the speakerphone.
But why is that?
Because you dropped it. Was it 2 years ago?
No, it was last summer.
Last summer at the bottom of the lake at the Weasties house.
Which we talked about on this podcast.
Which we talked about. And months, what was it, like 6 months later?
So in June of last year, I, much to your amusement, dropped my phone in the lake at Kendall and Jim Weasties lake house. And it just floated on down to the bottom. And it was still working, remember?
Cause it's like, still working now.
We kept checking it.
Oh, yeah.
And it was still on.
Yeah.
For like days, it was still, like, yeah. You could find my friends. It was still working. We're like, wow, this is crazy. I jumped in the lake, tried to go down there, but it was
so muddy because it was under their boat.
Yeah, it was like really not for, yeah, it was kind of scary.
Yeah.
But then Weasty went out there. He tried to find it. He couldn't find it.
Yeah.
But luckily, their girls were obsessed with finding it.
Leave it to kids to find it because they don't care how scary or dark or dim the water is. They will go down and they will find it.
But this, well, hold on.
I think
they didn't find it until the water went down. They drained the water in November.
Yeah.
So the phone
was there from like July to November.
June until November.
Sitting at the bottom of the lake.
Sitting at the bottom of the lake. They pull it out, bring it in. Give it to us, we plug it in, and it's still working.
It works.
That's it. Like, how is that not an Apple commercial?
It should be. Well, you know what's funny is...
And you're using it now.
Yeah.
So the phone in your hand was at the bottom of a lake.
Yeah.
For, what, June, July, August, September? 5 to 6 months.
Yeah.
Basically 6 months.
And it still works.
That phone in your hand was at the bottom of the lake for 6 months.
It's pretty crazy. And what's interesting is, I don't know if you did this, but I had to chat with AT&T to get the, because
you told them
yeah,
you told me the phone was at the bottom of the lake.
Yeah. Well, because so it had been blacklisted. The guy was like, oh, well, I can't, because I was trying to transfer the number from my other phone to this phone.
Yeah.
And he was like, oh, well, the phone's been blacklisted.
What does that mean?
Oh, that's what I said. I was like, I don't know what that means. He's like, well, like, did you report it as stolen or lost? And I was like, I just maybe assumed that you had reported it
as stolen. I reported it at the bottom of a lake.
Oh, okay. So apparently they blacklisted it so that if anyone found it, they wouldn't be able to use it until you called AT&T and then confirmed that it was your actual phone.
Okay.
So that's why they had to like text me a code and text you a code and like all that stuff.
Oh, okay.
Because it was like a security thing. Like you want to make sure it was like actually my phone. I didn't just like steal it from someone.
Oh, that you didn't find it at the bottom of the lake and you're trying to activate it.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow. So, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. So anyways, it's
working. So I was thinking the Apple event. I thought they were going to mention us today, but they didn't.
No, fortunately not.
Yeah. So luckily you didn't have to go buy a new phone.
And luckily I don't really care that much about high-tech phones, so I'm fine with the half-working phone.
It works. It's just you got to use a speakerphone.
I just always have to talk on speakerphone.
Or your professional AirPods.
But what speaking of that,
yeah,
that goes into my next thing that I've been noticing when it comes to trends in the world right now in reference to, I'm very obsessed with Gen Z trends, like things that they find interesting. And underconsumption-core is now the like new thing for Gen Z.
Underconsumption-core.
Underconsumption-core, like GORP-core, like ballet-core.
I'm under-consuming.
Under-consuming is now the cool
thing. So they're eating raw food?
No.
Oh.
What does that mean?
Like it's underconsumed?
Undercooked?
Undercooked.
Oh.
I don't know.
That's anything to
I don't know.
No, underconsumption meaning like...
Like they're eating less food than they need.
I didn't go out and just get a new phone. Oh, no. They're definitely still probably eating a lot. But no, not going out and just getting a new phone. Like I'm underconsuming by using an old phone.
Oh, okay.
So I am now part of underconsumption core by using this phone that we already had, so I don't have to buy a new one. So the whole thing is that everyone is tired of the influencers on TikTok and Instagram constantly consuming and making you feel this intense pressure to also consume,
yeah.
or else you will fall behind on some sort of trend, or you'll fall behind on, you know, the coolness factor or your or styles or whatever it may be.
Fulfill like, that need.
Since, I would say since 2020, I mean, consumption has always been a problem, especially in the US, but
yeah.
since 2020, I think really with the elevation of TikTok, consumption, and we see this because brands are reporting it too, like Gucci, like the brands that were not accessible to the average person or not in like the sphere of the average person's thought process is now targeting those people. Like they're targeting people that can't afford those brands. And we've talked about this on this podcast before.
Yeah, like luxury brands you never heard of 5 years ago.
Exactly.
They've been around for 50 years.
But oh, forever. Yeah, there's just all these brands that like were never in the purview of the average person. And now people, because of influencers, are so, the brands, I think, have jumped the shark and they send stuff to influencers and they have third parties sending, lending stuff to influencers. And so these influencers get these packages, they open the package, they do a reveal video, an unboxing video. Every single influencer I follow right now is opening some sort of suede, brown, big $10,000 bag.
Hmm.
How is every influencer able to just afford and or keep this $10,000 bag? Yeah. But what's sad is that then the average female or male, the average person is seeing this influencer, this average girl who lives in a one bedroom apartment and doesn't drive a car and, you know, whatever, like gets clearly cannot afford a $10,000 bag or at least afford one comfortably without a massive amount of credit card debt. They're not seeing that. They're just like, oh, well, is there something wrong with me because I'm not buying a $10,000 bag? I'm not consuming. So I think it's interesting that Gen Z has really decided like it's cheesy to buy all of these things that you can't afford. So just, and you know, it's, well, let me finish the thought. So just go buy vintage or go buy secondhand, which has always been like, I mean, I think we see like with the Real and, you know, a bunch of different secondhand.
I feel like using the Real Real is not under consuming though.
No, because it's almost like the it's like the overconsumption of.
You're going to Goodwill, okay, you're under consuming.
Yeah. Well, it depends. It depends on what you get the Real Real, because there's tons of stuff that is like cheap and then stuff that's expensive.
Okay.
But that's just an example. But yeah,
I'm under consuming this Rolex.
But it's also not just clothes, it's like makeup products, hair products, because think about every celebrity has literally come out with some sort of skincare makeup brand since the pandemic because they see how starved people are to overconsume all these products. So they come out with a line, and then you see the next line. And,
yeah.
Oh, we got to have this blush because this one's not good enough. And
they're probably all made in the same factory.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, and then now powder blush isn't good. Just liquid blush is good. But then a liquid stain is better than a liquid blush. But now people are saying powder is good. So it's this constant like trying to keep up with what's happening that causes the overconsumption. So anyways.
So they're not buying stuff anymore.
They're reusing stuff. Or they're like, if they have shampoo that they don't like. Another part of the underconsumption movement is that if you do buy something and you don't like it, don't just throw it away. Find a different way to use it. So like this girl did this whole TikTok video on it. She's like, so I bought this expensive shampoo and conditioner and I don't like it. Normally I would have just thrown it away, but I'm going to like use it as shaving cream or I'm going to use it as body wash. Or she's like, because shampoo and body wash are essentially the same thing.
Hmm.
Like it, she was just giving all these different examples of like ways you can use other products that you might not think of.
Welcome to Fight Club.
The first rule of Fight Club is you do not talk about Fight Club. The second rule of Fight Club is you do not talk about Fight Club.
Yeah. So tell us about, because I don't understand this reference, so.
I think people that were around in 1999 know of the movie Fight Club. That's what it was about. It wasn't about guys fighting. It was about consumerism and anti-consumerism. And yeah, you need to watch it. Yeah, the fact that you have not seen Fight Club or read Fight Club, because it's a book too.
Yeah.
That's like kind of crazy. Like I know we've talked about it 100 times,
yeah.
But we've got, I know there's times where you thought you saw it, but then you thought it was a different movie.
Yeah.
But Fight Club. Yeah. It's a, the guy, Tyler Durden, like he makes his own soap, you know,
smart.
And at the end, I won't give it away, but, yeah, that's what it's about.
Yeah. I think,
and it speaks to like at that point, like 1999, the internet was just starting, but wasn't something that people used to like shop.
Yeah.
So they were like we were talking about the J. Crew, catalog coming back. Mm-hmm. Like it just announced it's coming back. With like, so in the mail, you would get J. Crew catalog, Pottery Barn catalog, Crate and Barrel catalog. You get all these catalogs and they were just like all over everyone's house. And like, that's how people shopped.
Yeah.
And it's like, that's a big part of the movie too, is like, you don't need that. And like, it's like, goes to this whole scene where he's like looking through the catalog and like things are popping up in his apartment that he doesn't need, but it's just because he's been trained to be a consumer.
Yeah.
And he thinks that's why I exist, is I work and I make money and then I spend that money. And so the whole point of Fight Club is that you don't, that's not why you exist. You exist to experience life. And the kind of main premise of experiencing life is us beating the crap out of each other.
Yeah.
I mean, that part is not, probably not normal, but
maybe in some
parts. I don't think Gen Z is going to adopt that part of
it. No, they're not into fighting.
it's funny though. That was a big trend in the early 2000s when I was in my early 20s.
It's so interesting because I've even found myself really burnt out on influencers and like social media, to the point where like I was joking with my friend about this last week. It's become so cringe. Most influencers have become so cringy to me because they'll be like, so I'm so excited for the newest fall trends. And it's like they like list out their, they're like, fall trends I'm looking forward to in 2024. And it's like brown suede.
Right.
Loafers. Jane.
The same thing that's
and I'm like, every is this fall. Not, how is this any different than every single fall?
Unless you live in Miami.
Like, you must have a suede brown bag this fall. If not, you're a loser. And it's just like, I'm so burnt out on it. I literally this fall, I'm going to wear like my bright orange bag because I'm so, I don't want to wear the brown bag because now the brown bag is not cool to me because you all talk about stupid brown suede bags so much. And any girl my age will know exactly what I'm referencing right now because I guarantee it's burned in there. They've pre-ordered their brown bag. Stop.
Right.
Stop pre-ordering the brown bag.
Do you think the algorithm, I just had a thought, do you think the algorithm just doesn't apply to people in Florida?
What do you mean?
Like they don't get those. Like they wouldn't get that.
How do you know?
Because there's no seasons.
Yeah, I think maybe.
There's no like.
I don't know. One of the worst influencers that I follow who I'm like, how do you even afford this stuff? But she actually admitted she's in like 200 grand worth of credit card debt. Cause she was like, many of you are asking how I afford this. And like, I can't. It was kind of funny actually.
Okay.
But. But
was it like lesson learned?
She lives in like Orlando.
Was it like lesson learned? Like don't do this? Or
no,
like,
she was like, the way I look at it is like I could die tomorrow. So like I don't care about credit card debt because these things bring me joy.
Wow.
And I was like, I guess that's one way to look at it.
She's not married, I assume.
No, she is. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Really? Okay. Uh-huh. Oh, wow. So she didn't have a plan B then? Because I was going to say if she wasn't married, then plan B would be I'm going to find a guy to pay off that credit
card
debt.
Anyway,
that's not sustainable. You said
the whole point was she lives in Florida. And she's buying all stuff.
But is she buying fall brown?
Oh, yeah. She buys like everything from the Row.
Okay.
Everything she owns is from the Row or like the Margot bag. Like she's got every color of the Margot bag.
I saw on Substack today that someone found something from the Row at TJ Maxx. Did you see that?
No, but that would be wild. It's got to be fake. There's so many fake things from the Row.
It must be.
And that's the other thing is like I hate trendy items. Like I think the Row Margot bag is a beautiful bag. But now it's so trendy that you go on to like Hula, whatever, China shop online.
Temu,
whatever the other ones are. And they've got like 100 of them.
Yeah.
So it's just like, I don't know. When is it too much, you know?
I ask myself the same thing every time I see T Swift at a football game. Because baby, now we got bad blood. You know it used to be mad love. So take a look what you've done.
Why?
I don't know.
You ask when does it end?
Yeah.
why do you want it to end?
I thought it was going to end this week because they had the fake PR
That's
thing.
So weird. So those of you who haven't been following this, because most of you probably haven't, someone fabricated a fake PR like playbook around how Travis Kelce was going to handle his breakup with Taylor Swift and how it was going to, the press, you know, was going to, how they were going to release this article. September 28th, blah, 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 blah. It turns out the entire thing was fabricated. And the worst part is like, the worst part is it was fabricated on like a template that's an actual agent PR agency that they use.
Yeah, it's like a real company.
Yeah, and I'm thinking like, man, if I'm that PR agency, can you imagine the phone call that they were getting that day?
Yeah.
So it turns out it's false, and they were at the U.S. Open allegedly. Together, and they went out to dinner in Brooklyn together, and all chaos in the universe has been
calmed. What if, though, on September 28th, they do announce it?
I will cry. Because I
Will you renounce her?
No, I'll renounce
for
him.
For this just terrible, blatant...
Why would I renounce Taylor?
For lying to you. How as a Swiftie. Because she said it's false.
Well, maybe they haven't broken up yet. Maybe on the 28th, that's when she wants to break up with him.
Okay, but if they're saying it's false and then it actually comes out on the 28th, we know that they both were lying.
No, I won't.
And she lied to you. There's nothing she can do Wow.
No.
So are you excited about the new Beetlejuice movie?
Yeah, because we watched... Did we finish Beetlejuice last
time? Yeah, I made you watch Beetlejuice.
Yeah, watch the original one, which I think I had seen the... I don't know. I've seen some... Was there another version in between that one and the new one?
No, this is it.
But there was like a cartoon called
Beetlejuice. There was a cartoon.
Okay, so that's what I used to watch all the time.
That's what you were referencing, because you're like, oh yeah, I've seen it. But then I showed it to you, and you're like, wait, this doesn't look right.
Yeah,
you're
I used to watch cartoon. The cartoon.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So this... Yeah, so... Nikki saw the first original Beetlejuice for the first time ever last night.
The jump in the line, rock your body on time. Okay, I believe you jump in the line, rock your body on time. Okay, I believe you jump in the line, rock your body on time.
It was good. It was really good.
You thought it was really good. I think one thing we didn't talk about that I think you really appreciated that I forgot about movies in the 80s, how short it was.
I love a short movie.
It was so short.
Short King. Love it.
And also the fact that Michael Keaton is not, he's not even on the screen that much.
No, he's not even that big of a character.
I mean,
Winona Ryder is by far the biggest character.
She is, yeah. And I was explaining to you how Winona Ryder
she was 16 in that movie.
Yeah, she was like the girl of my childhood. Like that movie, I think, kicked it off. Then there's Heathers, which you haven't seen. And then like all the movies that followed that.
And it's so crazy.
Crazy.
Because to me, I only think of her as the woman who shoplifted.
Yeah.
Until.
Stranger Things. Yeah.
And what's wild, because I was looking it up before we started recording, is so in 2001, she got caught stealing like $5,500 worth of stuff from Saks Fifth Avenue. And got charged with like grand theft. Which is kind of crazy.
I mean, she was super famous.
She literally quit acting. She like disappeared for a decade and would do like little things here and there.
Yeah, because she was so embarrassed.
But I was thinking about today. If some celebrity got caught stealing $5,000 worth of stuff at Saks, people would be like, that's weird.
Yeah.
But they would never like cancel them. They wouldn't care. No one would care. Like think of all the crazy stuff Kanye West has done.
Oh, yeah.
People have tried to cancel him. They can't even cancel him.
Yeah. No, today it wouldn't even be like the story of the day.
Yeah. Yeah. They'd be like, Taylor Swift stole $5,000. That's really weird. But like, oh, well, move on.
Anyway. So we'll go see the follow up because we're pretty excited.
You're going to book tickets this week.
Yeah. We're actually going to get it. We're going to a movie theater.
If you book the tickets.
During the week. We'll see.
Okay.
The big story of the week, which we've got some personal connection to, is the $100 chicken nuggets at the U.S. Open, which is we also included in the Culture Edit newsletter this week.
Which everyone, I think, is misunderstanding because people are just like, ooh, $100 chicken nuggets, that's like price gouging. But it's not. The chicken nuggets have caviar. They have like all these special dipping sauces.
It's elevated. It's like an elevated fried chicken place.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if you add caviar to anything, it's going to make it really expensive.
Yeah. And we have friends that got it.
We'll text them and report back. Was it actually worth the price? Because it did look good.
Yeah.
And you know I love caviar and you know I love chicken fingers. So it seems like a good combination.
Yeah. So we got a lot of feedback on last week's episode.
We did. We got a lot of great feedback. Everyone really liked the business talk. So I think we're going to have to do more of that.
I mean, I had several folks tell me that it was their favorite episode ever.
We had people say that it changed their perspective on how they were going to conduct themselves in work environments.
Exactly.
Which that's the whole point. Like if we can help one person... Based on our observations from working with so many companies, that's gold. I love that.
I had multiple people tell me that it made me personally rethink how I approach working in the office and how visible and present I am. I also had several folks say, so glad you said that. So it's not just me saying that all the time because I think that. I already go to the office and I'm a leader. I think that it's good for me to hear that.
Yeah.
That I'm not wrong in thinking that as well. So. A lot of great feedback, and we don't do a lot of business, like we have done a lot of business content. We go back and forth. I think because we see, you know, we're always kind of measuring traction. And so we're never sure whether or not people are interested in that. So I think it's a good way to combine both culture and business content. Yeah.
So I don't know. We just kind of try to do a mixture because I think different parts of the audience want different things. You know, we try to deliver to everybody.
We got to be everything to everybody. It's a great strategy. It's
exhausting. So one thing we talked about last week is that we would address really like benefits because that it is the season of benefits, open enrollment.
Yeah, you gave everyone that preview and then you got all the feedback like everyone was looking forward to. Chad Look, enlightening everyone
we are
on
not
benefits.
Benefits consultants, okay? Chad knows has a lot of knowledge around it because he ran an HR function for a long time. So he has, you know, he's had a lot of insight into it, but we are by no means benefits consultants. We're not like in the nitty gritty of it every day. Now, I'm coming from a place of pure consumerism in that I didn't used to understand anything about benefits and over time have learned the basics. And it just always sparks a light bulb in my mind of like, okay, most people are like me where they don't have this institutional knowledge around benefits and even like compensation, how it all works. And so I think keeping it very high level, we're not going to tell you what plan to sign up with. Don't call us asking us whether you should get a HSA, PPO, whatever options you have. Like, don't ask us that because everything's different. But I will say that I think it's really important to understand because what I do hear a lot is people complain about what their company's offering without really knowing why they're complaining about it, other than like maybe an initial perception of like, oh, I used to be able to go to that doctor and now I have to switch doctors. And it's not always that cut and dry. And sometimes I think, and I'm not saying you always have to give big companies like the benefit of the doubt because there's definitely some like evil companies out there, but for the most part, I think a lot of companies, big companies, are trying to do right by their employees when they decide on the benefits that they're going to be offering.
Yeah, we're talking about medical benefits specific because it's about to be open enrollment season for a lot of organizations and employees out there are going to be sent a lot of information about time to renew, time to pick your plan, time to, you know, look at the new things that we're rolling out. You asked me to think about like what are the things behind the scenes that the average employee doesn't know about when it comes to medical benefits. So that's what I was trying to think of. And so I categorized this into a couple of different ways, like things I wish I could have said to our workforce as the head of HR for a multi-million dollar company. When you're
multi-billion dollar.
Billion.
Yeah.
Did I say billion or million?
I think you said million.
Oh, maybe billion with a B. I think it starts with the fact that I think most people don't understand that at a fundamental level, organizations have two different approaches to medical benefits. One is they're either insured fully. So like think about insurance, like how you would purchase it as a consumer. You can do that as, and that's what I think most people think happens. Like you can do that as a company. Like I'm going to Blue Cross Blue Shield. We're a company and we're going to buy insurance for our people, right? And the premiums are going to be split 70-30, which I don't know if most people know that. That's typically the split. Like my point is that when you're paying your $400 a month premium, or let's say it's a $300 a month premium, if your company is fully insured, they're paying $700 a month for you to be at that company and have insurance. That's the first thing I think most people don't know. Second thing is that most large organizations are actually self-insured. So they're not actually even buying insurance from Blue Cross, Blue Shield, Aetna, Cigna, whatever. They're actually absorbing all the costs themselves. So they figured out a lot of smart actuarial people out there and they figure out, okay, this is a much more cost-effective way for us to provide insurance to our people. When Nikki gets sick and she goes to the doctor, we're paying for it. The company is paying for it. We're like, we're writing the check. Now you would say, well, but my company, our carrier is Blue Cross Blue Shield. Well, they're using them as an administrator to administrate everything because they have the infrastructure to do that.
Yeah.
But
yeah, because they can't have Piedmont Hospital calling a company directly and being like, all right, here's the bill. So they're just the third party that's essentially collecting the bill, making sure it gets paid, all of that.
Exactly. And so you're, as a company, you're paying that bill And it depends on the finances of it. But the big element there is there's a lot of risk in that. And again, there's a lot of actuarial science that goes on behind this, but you're accepting the risk of the number of claims are going to come in over the course of the year. We're going to estimate that on an annual basis, and we accept that is something that we're willing to do versus being fully insured, because fully insured is going to be more expensive for us. Now, there's also something called stop-loss insurance. So it kind of caps what a self-insured company will have to pay if claims get out of hand. And so you can have a situation where, again, I think the I did a little bit of research for this, like the average company is around $50 to $100 million. That's where it starts to make sense for them to become fully insured. So most big companies are self-insured. So the interesting thing, I think I don't think most employees understand that, but then I also don't think they understand that the variable of cost, which is something that drove me to really try and figure out how do we suppress costs. Mm-hmm. It's around how many unhealthy people you have in your organization, yeah, because unhealthy people in your organization are the ones that cost a lot. Outside of the random things that happen, like, you know, cancer or, a lot of childbirth issues, yeah, things like that. But if you have a really unhealthy population, it drives cost up for the company. Mm-hmm. And then that in turn drives cost up for the individual employees that are paying.
And so let me stop you there, because a lot of times I hear people saying, every year my insurance keeps getting more and more and more and more. Why is that? I don't understand. And
that's a really big question.
That's a big question. Yeah. But I think you could say a short answer that is just part of the equation, but is a very straightforward answer, is that the population as a whole is also getting more unhealthy.
That's a big part of it. And that's why you see so many organizations focus on wellness. Like I think a lot of people think the wellness initiatives are like cheesy or like eye rolls or whatever, but they're real, in that if you can get your population just a little bit, just like a few percentage points healthier, it's millions of dollars to the bottom line.
If you can get just a few people to start getting on the stair climber instead of sitting at their desk.
Yes. It's like, as a head of HR, I'd walk around just like, you see unhealthy people and you're just like, you don't understand the impact that you're having, not only on yourself, your family, but now you're also having an impact on the organization, all the people that you work with. So if you can just get people to get healthier, that can be a big part of what can help you control costs. The bigger question of like, why does it get it more expensive every year? I mean, that drove me crazy. I mean, it does. My high level answer is that the system obviously is broken. There are too many hands in the honey jar. Mm-hmm. Like, there are so many different entities and stakeholders that are tacking on fees, that are involved in getting a 1 cent per employee per month here and there. It's incredible. Like, it's truly incredible if you start breaking down all the different entities that are involved in healthcare. So that's the big thing I think people don't know about. When they're thinking about how much value am I getting about around the insurance, I will say, as a young single person, your health insurance is cheaper. And I know it's annoying. And I think about like myself as a young single healthy person, whatever I was paying in premium, let's say it's $300 a month, I'd go a whole year without ever going to the doctor.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that's really, really annoying. I know that's really, really annoying because we go through it, but you got to consider your insurance as really a catastrophic stop loss for yourself, for your individual, because it can happen pretty quickly. And like, I even had personal experience where I probably didn't go to the doctor for years and years. In 2009, I was in a terrible bike accident, cycling accident in a race, and broke my hip and almost took a dirt nap. And I remember that in itself was like $175,000, because I could see all the costs because I was head of HR.
Yeah.
And I don't know what my deductible was. I feel like it was like probably $5,000. It was like high to me. But that's the kind of like catastrophic protection that you're giving yourself by paying that $300, $400, $500 a month.
I think another thing that I see, so this is kind of like all things that contribute to a company having to raise the cost of insurance every year is the way people use, or the way people use medical care, or the way people address medical care for different needs that they're having. So, like, for example, I'll see people, and we all know these people, that go to the emergency room for everything. Like, they have a cough, emergency room. Yep. They stub a toe, emergency room. Like, or they're going to urgent care constantly because there's not, like, because they don't feel like taking the time to make an appointment with their general, you know, their doctor. So they just go straight to urgent care. All those things cost more money. Like, the people who call an ambulance because they have a headache, you know, and the ambulance, yeah. I mean, they're like, oh, it's fine. It's only going to cost me $300. But that might cost you $300, but that's going to cost, let's just say, the company $700.
Yep.
So for every single time you call an ambulance, the company's saying, oh my gosh, like, so many people called ambulances and went to the emergency room. And so that gives a perception that the more things you use at a higher cost, like an ambulance or emergency room or urgent care, it drives the cost up. And when you look at that at the end of the year as a company, you're like, well, we've either got a really unhealthy population. So we're going to have to cover a lot more because these people are constantly going to the emergency room. Now, what needs to change, and, you know, we've had a lot of clients try to do campaigns around this because it does tend to be like a majority of like frontline individuals that like their default is just, especially if you live in a rural area where there's like a hospital desert, let's just say, or like general, like like you don't have kind of a general practitioner that you can go to because you have to drive 30 miles to get there, but there's an emergency room. That's why people will tend to go to the urgent care or the emergency rooms.
Yep.
So companies do try to do campaigns around, like, especially nowadays, use telemedicine.
Yep.
Like, use telemedicine. And I know you might think, oh, well, it doesn't matter to me because if I go to the emergency room, it just costs me this much. But you are driving up the cost if you do that.
If everyone could change just that one simple thing in terms of a mind shift, that would be a big impact. But you asked me to think about, like, I don't think employees understand how much money.
Yeah.
Companies are spending on health insurance.
Yeah, because
like, thought it's like insurance, yeah. Right? Like, so I'm paying my premium and then it's insurance company's problem. So I've explained to you, and most organizations, I think
most people think that their company's not paying anything, that they're just the ones paying for
right.
it.
So on fully insured, like the traditional, like in your mind model, they're paying 70% of the bill. Mm-hmm. But most large organizations, again, are self-insured, so they're paying all of it. So I did a little research for, let's just call a fake company, a big company, 1,000 employees. So not even that crazy, just 1,000 employees. You still kind of know everyone at 1,000 employees. Like, you kind of know everyone's name. It's like 1,000 person high school, right? So assume that 60% of employees are individual single coverage, and 400 employees, 40% are on family coverage. That 60% of the single coverage employees would equate to about $5.1 million, and the family coverage would equate to $8.6 million, total of $13.7 million, almost $14 million annually that the company is paying out of pocket into medical coverage for its employees.
So imagine that's your company.
Yeah.
And you've worked really hard to build this company. You've worked really hard to, as an executive, to continue to focus on the bottom line every year so you can employ more people, so you can provide a higher salary, provide more benefits, and you're paying $13 to $17 million a year on medical benefits because you're like, this is the right thing to do. We have to provide medical benefits, and we have to provide good medical benefits. And then all you do is get bashed by employees saying, our medical benefits suck. The company is terrible. They're evil. They don't cover anything. And they've made me change doctors. Like, I guess it's kind of giving that like other perspective of how hard that is, I think, as an executive team to like get that feedback when like you were in these rooms with these really smart people doing all this actual science to figure out the best possible way. Now, granted, companies aren't going to be like, oh, we're going to spend more than we can afford so we can put benefits first. No, I mean, they're obviously trying to save money in any way they can, but not at the expense of like having necessarily terrible coverage for employees. And they're still spending millions and millions and millions of dollars.
Yeah.
So think of...
And I don't want people to think that we're just sitting here defending companies. I think it's more of just being enlightened around that there's actual cost to the bottom line.
Yeah.
And a lot of companies are cutting, they're cutting so razor thin on whether or not they even make money.
Yeah.
Right. So as an employee, like adding an employee is such a big decision because it's not only the compensation, it's not only the time, but it's also the cost. Mm-hmm. And the cost is includes medical costs and all of your benefits costs. And I think a lot of people don't understand that total benefits, understanding the total compensation yeah. around how much I cost the organization, am I providing? And that's what leaders look at is like, are they providing value for us to bring on that much cost? Now, I will say if a company's making a lot of money, I do think that there's more opportunity to alleviate some of these costs and reduce some of these, I think from a benefits perspective, some of these pain points that employees are experiencing now. Because I look at like right now, the big thing now, I'd say big thing for now, like for the last 10 years, high deduction plans. Like yeah. that's where everyone's been going. So high deduction plans. I remember when $5,000 high deductible plan was like we didn't even consider that.
Yeah, it was like
now
insane.
That's like the low end yeah. of the high deductible plan. And so I definitely think if organizations are making a lot of money, there's opportunity for them to reduce cost for yeah. the employee on that side. Yeah. One of the things you asked me was why are there changes to plans so often? Like mm-hmm. why do employees feel like there's always changes? And the answer, there's a couple of different reasons why. I mean, one thing I would say as from a leadership perspective, especially if you're making these decisions, if you're the CEO, ultimately the CFO or the CHRO, you're thinking about the experience of the employee from a premium perspective. So how much are they paying in premium? And you're trying to move items around the chessboard to make sure that the premium doesn't go up because that's out of my paycheck as an employee. And I took a lot of pride. I mean, we would go 3, 4, maybe even 5 years, which is, I think, unheard of. I mean, we have one client that hasn't had a premium change in like the last 4 years.
Yeah.
But that's like, you're doing a lot of work behind the scenes to make sure the premiums don't go up. And so the bottom line, though, is it's cost. Mm-hmm. It's cost and experience. And if you're self-insured, then you've got a lot more control around the experience.
Yeah.
If you're fully insured, you're just taking what Blue Cross Blue Shield gives you off of the shelf.
Yeah.
And they're changing it because they're constantly trying to figure out how they make more money at the end of the day.
Yeah.
And so that's why if you're seeing changes every day, I mean, every year, your company could be fully insured. And yeah. that's why. But if you're self-insured, you're moving things around, if you're smart, you're doing a lot of work behind the scenes to figure out what's our population look like from a health perspective. What do they look like from a utilization perspective? Are they going to the emergency room often? Are they engaging in our wellness programs? And you can move money around in these different programs trying to effectively insulate the employees from having to absorb more costs. At the end of the day, though, there gets to a point where there's nothing you can do.
Yeah.
And if you, especially if you're growing, mm-hmm. And you're growing a lot, then you're all of a sudden, there would be years where we would get so many claims, like we would have a lot of like really sick babies, for instance, mm-hmm. In 1 year that would just completely blow the budget out of the water. And then there's nothing you can do. Like we've spent more money than we ever thought we would. And so we've now have to change our plan as a result. We have to go to a high deductible plan.
Has there ever been like, and I'm genuinely asking this question because I don't know, but has there ever been an instance where there's been like discrimination against hiring people because they appear to be unhealthy? Like, has there ever been lawsuits about that or?
I don't know. That'd be a question for Todd Abin.
Because I feel like if you were.
There's states that have state laws against discriminating against people based on their weight.
Yeah.
Like in Michigan, it's called the Elliott-Larsen Act. Mm-hmm. And you cannot discriminate against someone based on their weight, which includes medical coverage, includes hiring, includes mm-hmm. everything. There's not many, but I'm not on the razor edge.
Well, and I was thinking about like even like families, like it doesn't necessarily behoove a company to hire someone who they know has kids or a family, because that's so much more expensive than hiring like a single person that doesn't have kids.
That's not even in the hiring manager's realm of consideration, though.
Yeah.
If they're thinking about, I don't want to hire someone because of kids, it's because they have some type of preconceived notion that they're not going to work hard because they have kids. Yeah. They're not thinking, oh, because it's going to cost the company more.
Yeah.
Hiring managers, they don't even understand what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Right. So like, you only have a couple of people at the very top understand what we're talking about.
But I'm thinking more of like a small business perspective. Like if it's that, you know, provide, like, let's say you have like 100 people, you know, because that's still a small business. I would have a hard time hiring someone that I perceived as unhealthy, or knowing that that would cost the company so much more money.
Yeah, I mean, well, I mean, this will probably be Exhibit A in your deposition one day.
All right, just cut this out.
But is that because you're thinking that you would be thinking about the cost, or is it because you would be considering work habits?
The cost.
Okay.
Because, I mean, I don't think it necessarily has to do with, like, work. I mean, it could be both, but I was just wondering if that's ever been, like, a big issue.
I don't know. That's a good question. That could be something. We need to add it when we have a lawyer on it.
Yeah.
One day we'll have Eddie C. on.
Yeah, I'm just really curious about that. Because as, like, America continues to get more unhealthy.
Yeah.
It has to be, like, or, like, will there ever be a time?
I mean, you can discriminate against hiring if the person has a disability, but can you discriminate against someone because
they're choosing, you
perceive that they're unhealthy?
Yeah.
And I think the question would come down to whether or not your perception of them being unhealthy was associated with a real or perceived disability. That would be covered under the ADA. I don't know.
But that's like, good. Think about if you know, if someone comes into your office and they smell like cigarette smoke.
Yeah.
And they're there for an interview. I'd be like,
I just don't want someone that smells like cigarettes.
Well, smoke okay, around. There's that. But you already know they're going to have massive health issues. So why bring that person on?
I'm just like, how stupid are they? Because they smoke and it's 2024?
Yeah, but there's still a lot of people, you know.
Really? Are there? I don't know.
I mean, have you been in New York City? I guess so. Atlanta, I will say, is a very smoke-free city.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of people who smoke cigarettes here, like just like walking around smoking cigarettes.
Yeah, you just don't see it.
No.
What else on medical? Now that everyone has questions. Either stopped listening or they have fallen asleep. You know, I think if I'm a young person and I'm presented every other year with these tough decisions, the one thing I would just think about is utilization. It just comes down to whether or not I really go to the doctor that often. How risky is my lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you don't go to the doctor that often, I go high deductible plan, it's catastrophic coverage, put that money into savings instead of putting it into a medical plan. If you don't go to the doctor that often, you do Don Pon every Saturday, maybe you go with a little bit less conservative plan because your risk is a little bit higher of getting injured and going to the hospital with broken bones. So like, that's ultimately what it comes down to. Families, I mean, I think that's just a pure financial play, and like whether or not your kids are healthy or not.
Yeah.
But it's all about utilization. And you just got to, there's no right or wrong answer. You just got to really, really think about it. You got to really think about how often do I need to go to the doctor? Because there are people that have existing conditions that go a lot, and they have, you know, we didn't even talk about drug coverage, but you know, that can be a really big part of a medical plan, is what the drug coverage looks like. And so for relatively healthy people that aren't on regular prescription drugs, you know, it sucks, but you just gotta go with a high deductible plan and save that money. Hopefully this was enlightening, and that if anything, you know, that if you work for a big company, they're actually paying a lot of money for your medical insurance.
Yeah.
They are paying a lot, and I'm not saying that to defend them. I just think it's important for people to know that, because I think I knew as a leader that people did not know that.
Yeah.
And it was not something that I could talk about.
And it's like, there's all these things as like business owners or business leaders that you experience, and you can't ever talk about it with anyone. You can never like talk about the frustrations other than maybe like with other executives or other business owners. But I think like, being a business owner myself, like us having this business, it's given me totally different perspective. I think it's like when people become parents and they're like, oh my God, I like gave my mom so much crap growing up. And now that I'm a mom, like I like have a different perspective. It's kind of the same as when you start your own business or not. People are going to come after me. Like, it's not the same. The kid's not the same as the business. But like, that's not what I mean. I mean that all it is giving you different perspective. And like, I was joking with Chad the other day, cause he like, anytime like our payroll is run, the payroll gets run and then it goes, I get a text message about how much money is like leaving the bank account. Yep. And it's like, your payroll is running. It's like text message on a Saturday night. Have fun. and like Chad was unaware that I was
seriously
receiving,
like a Saturday
oh,
night.
Oh yeah. Like it's torture.
Brutal.
And I was receiving all these notifications about like payroll's run, contractors have been paid, blah, 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 all this stuff. And you know, catch me on the wrong night or the wrong week. And that is a very frustrating text message to receive.
Because as a business owner, that's money out of your pocket.
Exactly. And you're looking, you're like, I'm looking for productivity and I'm really just looking for a little bit of appreciation. And not even appreciation. I'm just looking for you to not be appreciative. Like I think companies see so much like anger towards the company that is a lot of cases like unwarranted. Like I see
yeah, it's frustrating.
And it's like that text message every Saturday. Like if you feel unappreciated, or if you feel like people aren't giving discretionary effort, that's a very frustrating like thing to see, you know?
You said that managers in big companies, if they got that text message every week or every other week, they would completely change how they manage people.
100%. Because you see so much waste. Like you see so many managers that don't have purview to the way that their department or the way that their group affects the bottom line of the entire company. And not to, again, like it's funny because I think people would say like, oh, Nikki and Chad are like defending these big companies that have so much money. But it's not about that. It's more about like contributing to the greater good and not taking away from it so that more people can have jobs and so that more people can have better benefits. Because if you have all this if you have this dead weight of people who they work from home all the time, they don't actually do the work, instead of 8 hours a day, they're working 3 hours a day. That's a lot of dead weight.
Oh boy, don't get Nikki started on work from home again. Second week in a row.
But that's impacting a lot of people. It's impacting, you know, it all adds up. So it's kind of like back to credit card debt. You know, $20 here, $50 here, blah, blah. All of a sudden you got a $200,000 credit card bill and you're like, whoa, how did that happen?
Yeah.
So anyways.
Well, hopefully this was entertaining and you're not asleep. If you are, time to wake up. We'll play music right here. And then, maybe next time we'll talk about, we'll take the other side of the coin and talk about how unfair we think traditional compensation structure and practices are, and criticize companies.
I have a strong opinion on that, especially pay transparency.
I know, we both do.
So.
All right. Well, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for joining us.
You didn't even mention this. I think it's the first time ever you didn't mention like when and where it is. Because I was looking forward to this because this, I think, is the first time it's Monday night and we're recording this
Monday
episode.
Night. And then we have to go home and edit it tonight. So that'll be fun. Monday night in the office.
Yeah. I mean, we thought we were going to do an early Monday morning, but, you know,
meetings popped up.
That's the way we do it. So
it's the way the cookie crumbles, as what do they say that in Anchorman or?
I'm not sure. Maybe
that's the way the cookie crumbles.
All right,
it's like a sign off.
Thanks for joining us and Ron Burgundy.
You've never even seen Anchorman.
I know.
See, you make fun of me for not seeing Fight Club, but you've never even seen Anchorman. So
Fight Club's not a stupid movie. I don't watch stupid movies.
You just said Fight Club is a stupid movie?
It's not a stupid movie.
Anyways, thanks for all the feedback for last week's episode. We love the feedback. Keep telling us. If you completely disagree with us, tell us that as well. We love it all. Like, subscribe, share, do all the things that you need to do to share this with your friends. And we will see you all next week, or talk to you all next week.
All right.